And we have one more session to go before the lunch break. And may I please invite Associate Professor Dr. Jintavee Khlaisang from Faculty of Education, Chulalongkorn University, moderator of the following session on stage, please. Thank you. And please join me to welcome her. So Dr. Jintavee, now the stage is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Waraswan, for the introduction of me. Good morning, everyone. It is very my honor to be the moderator for this session. Today, in this session, we're going to have four delighted invited speakers and from four different countries. So the agenda would be presenter will give the 15-minute talk about the overview of MOOC in the program and course level. And then after that, we will have around 45 minutes for the discussion for further elaboration and in-depth information about each program and course. So may I first invite the first speaker, and of course, the ladies always come first, right? So we will let me introduce our first speaker, Dr. Ines Jaurena, who is the associate professor at Spanish Distance Education University, and she formerly a director of OER program for continuing education and lifelong learning. So please welcome her.
Good morning, and I'm very honored for this invitation to be here, and I think I'm the only European person in the room, so I think I have a lot of things to learn from you, and I would like just to show you my experience in my university. So it's a university institutional program, and also some course experience as a MOOC teacher myself, but as Wesley said, we are all learners, and I join a lot of MOOCs from different platforms, and I'm sure I will join some of the Asia-Pacific MOOCs as well. Okay, the presentation is coming, but I will briefly explain. I come from a distance education university, and we teach distance mode, which is more and more online mode. And in this sense, I have it's not a disagreement with that none of us had experience in MOOCs, but because I think in the distance education and open education universities, we have been doing massive online education for many, many years. It could not be open, sometimes it was, but so the experience from open universities, and this is a feeling shared by many open universities also in Asia, that we have, for us, it's not such an innovative thing, the MOOC, but it became very popular, so we also joined the program. So to contextualize a bit more, in Europe, there is not anything like this Asia-Pacific initiative or very public or Ministry of Education's run programs, but there are two initiatives. I only mentioned one. There is the Open Up Ed Education, which is a website. It is not a platform, but a MOOC aggregator. They inform about different MOOCs run by different universities. And it was led, this portal, by the Association for Distance Teaching Universities in Europe with the support from European Commission. And one different or added value they have is they have a quality label. If you want to join that platform, you need to pass through the quality checklist they have. But it's currently they don't have the European Commission support, so this one. Okay, sorry. So I'm not sure how, which will be the future for this. There is also another initiative called Open Education Europa. Also, this is a European Commission portal. It's also MOOC aggregator. At the national level, we don't have any national strategy or national like SMOOC. It could be Spanish MOOCs like JMOOC or TMOOC or KMOOC. And there was a private initiative called Miriadax that is run by bank and an IT and telephone company. And they provide a platform for universities in Spain and Latin American countries. And we were partners at the beginning, but we are not partners anymore. And I can tell you about this later if you wish. So we developed our own initiative, MOOC initiative, in the university. And we are a public university. And in our mission, it is to provide access to higher education to anybody that is interested in that and meets the requirements to join higher education. So that's why we launched the UNED OER program. It's called UNED Abierta, which means Open UNED. And it was launched in 2012, but the courses started in 2013. You have the links there if you wish to join. Briefly about my university, we were founded in more than 40 years ago, and is the biggest university, public university, and university in general in Spain, with almost 200,000 students every year, and we are distance mode, which means most of the teaching and the activity is online. But we have also some regional centers in different cities in Spain. And students can go, it's volunteer, can go there and meet a face-to-face tutor for academic questions, also administrative questions. And we teach all the levels in higher education, from undergraduate bachelor courses to doctoral studies, and also MOOCs. MOOCs are a very small part of our academic offer, but in number of learners, it's quite big experience. So these are some data and figures about our MOOCs platform. Currently, we are using open edX, like Thai MOOC, and maybe other Asian initiatives. Before, we had another platform. Open edX didn't exist yet, so we had our own platform. It was called Open MOOC. But now we move to open edX, which is more widely used all over the world. And the first edition, it was very successful with more than 200,000 learners. And the second edition, this is when I was the head of the program, and most of the data I will show are from this second edition, for more than 60,000 learners. And now from 2015, I don't have all the figures, but we have more and more MOOCs taking place. And the most popular MOOCs, talking about the subject, most of our courses, our MOOCs are in the social science area. We have also some courses in science and engineering, but most of them are social sciences and humanities. And the most popular are language courses for Spanish speakers, English and German for Spanish speakers, also those related to business and entrepreneurship and accounting. So other more specialized courses that maybe require a bigger background and previous knowledge don't have so many learners. This is the current interface. You can see it's open edX, like it looks familiar. And currently, some of our courses are related to professional development and teacher education. I think Dr. Pong also mentioned about professional development aspect. And our MOOCs are proposed by individual professors or group of professors. So any professor in the university can prepare a MOOC. And here you see the process. The professors send the proposal. They have to fill a form with some requirements. For instance, it's a requirement to be a doctor, to have a PhD, to run a MOOC in my university. And you see there are some criteria. The courses don't have to meet all of them, but at least some of them. So we are promoting especially MOOCs related to our other regular academic offer, like master programs. Is the case that, for instance, Dr. Pong said, it's related to already going happening courses. Also, introductory courses that can give background for students who want to join our regular courses. Also, courses related to research projects or research groups working in my university that they want to show another way of showing research results beyond academic publication. And also, we have courses with collaborating institutions like UNESCO chairs we have in my university, other chairs with other companies or foundations, and also courses that present an innovative character, so that they want to introduce something new that could have also an impact on changing our regular offer. These are the criteria. This is studied by the commission, and the university council has to approve, and then all the process for developing the course and implementing starts. And about the characteristics, I would say, I don't know if you're familiar with the XMOOC and CMOOC differences. Well, this would be two extremes in the spectrum of MOOCs. We would be more in the more traditional way of developing MOOCs and developing teaching, which is a very information transmission based. So we have video lectures, we have quizzes, which are automatic assessment. And some courses introduce peer assessment, some of them don't. And here there are some differences because some courses, for instance, teachers or professors want to be more present and they are participating and promoting participation in the forum and replying to questions. Others are not present at that moment. So there are differences. And the main reason professors say the reason why they wanted to have a MOOC and they made a proposal to the university is to experiment and try things that they couldn't maybe try first in the regular courses. Well, this is the look, the interface. So you see it's quite traditional with modules, and this would be videos and text, and then self-assessment and forum. This is the typical structure in our MOOCs. And then in my case, this is a course that I have, MOOC that I have. I have a final activity that is an assignment where I try to go beyond reproduction and assimilation, and learners have to reflect and think and write a proposal themselves about how they would use this the course contents in their own teaching practice. This is for teacher training. And then we always have a survey about what they think about the course to try to improve in coming editions. And about our participants, who they are. One surprising thing, at least to me, is that when they join, they have very big expectations about completing the course and even applying for a certificate, sometimes a paid for a certificate. But this doesn't happen at the end. So something is happening there in the middle, and that's why the learning analytics and the surveys are so useful. And the profile in some sense matches the profile of learners in other platforms. For instance, most of the learners already have a university degree or are studying at university. So we are reaching already educated learners. Not so many with basic education, or most of them are working or are unemployed, but not most of them are full-time students, and most of them are they are all ages, but most of them are in the middle ages, well, or young, until 45. I think this is different, for instance, from the course that Dr. Pong was showing. They were very young people. And most of the learners are women, except in the engineering courses, most of them are women. And it was their first MOOC experience for most of them. So they didn't have any experience with any other platform. And some of them had, with Coursera mainly, or on other platforms. And one thing that is relevant, and it raises a lot in the academic publication, is the completion rates, which are low also in our MOOCs. And to me, this is not so worrying, because I think most of our learners, their idea, this is something strange, because they say at the beginning that they wanted to complete the course, but at the end they don't. But I don't think it should be the most relevant thing to think about, the completion rates. But just for your information, some of the learners, they don't even start the course after registration. Well, 77% do something in the course, like watch the videos or do the quizzes. Less than 20% complete all the course, and from those, less than 20% get a paid certificate. In the overall numbers, it is about 13% of the learners who complete the course, the completion rate in our the average. Some courses have higher and some lower rates. Because I don't have much time, I have chosen some challenges that we face and I think are relevant. One is, and it's a challenge we have faced in my institution since the beginning and we still face, is how to integrate the MOOC with in the overall academic offer in the university. So they are not separated, so we can make links with the other offer. One important thing is that the hypothesis before the launching of our MOOCs in 2012 from the people who thought about that project at the before was that most of the MOOC learners would be our own university students. So our UNED graduate or postgraduate learners would be the same that in the MOOCs, and it was not like that. So we are reaching a different audience, a different people that could be attracted to our university regular programs. So we have to make that those links. And first thing we did is to approve a regulation so learners who take a MOOC and get a certificate, they can get that recognized in the undergraduate courses. It's only valid for our own university degrees, so they wouldn't get recognition in other Spanish universities or any other university in the world. But it's important that we try to establish those links with other regular courses. And also to take advantage of the possibilities of doing research and innovation in the MOOCs, so they can be later on applied in our regular courses. And I think Dr. Pong's experience with learning analytics, for instance, is very interesting. We don't have so advanced things, but I wish, because OpenEdX offers the learning analytics apps or plugins, but we didn't apply that so far. But I think that's important, and to experiment also with the content formats, the type of videos, shorter, longer, also text or interactive content. So to try to experiment with all that and see how it works, so we can use that later in our regular distance courses, in the graduate or postgraduate courses. Also, I think it's very important, and this is one of the main challenges, is the peer interaction. I think in MOOCs, peers are very important, and we should try to promote more interaction and peer assessment and peer discussion, that in some courses it doesn't happen in so much because of this structure of the course. You don't need to interact with other peers to complete the course, but I think it's very powerful because we have very diverse learners with very different experience, so we have to try to integrate that. And another challenge, it has to do with the financial aspects. We never wanted to get revenue from the MOOCs, but we wanted to reach financial sustainability. So it could have a balance because, well, you may be familiar with the economic crisis in Europe and especially in Spain. So we couldn't, as a university, we couldn't invest too much money on the MOOCs, but we had to reinforce and put promote especially our regular courses. So we were trying to reach financial sustainability in the MOOC program. And some ideas have been, and this is happening, the material and the content and the videos, for instance, we produce for the MOOCs, they are reused in the regular courses. So we take advantage of that same same resource. Also, we try to be efficient in the use of the cost and the different departments' support. Also, we can get some revenue from some finance from the paid certificates. And this is linked to recognition. If we recognize that in the academic programs, maybe learners can apply more for certificates. And something that we didn't reach to measure yet, but it would be important to know how many students, new students, are we attracting from the MOOCs, given that they were not already our own students. And this is all from, there are more challenges. I only wanted to highlight some of them. Here you have my email in case you want to ask me, and I will be around these 2 days, so please, anything you want to know. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Professor Ines, for sharing such a fruitful information with us today. So may I invite the next invited speaker, Associate Professor Dr. Thanomporn Laohajaratsang, who is the Director of the Information Technology Service Center and also Associate Professor of the Department of Educational Technology, Faculty of Education, ChiangMai University, Thailand. And also, most important, she's also my teacher when I was in undergrad.
Okay. Thank you very much for the nice presentation. And Swadi Naha. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizer of this important event for giving me great opportunity to be here with all of you today. But I have to confess first, I did the rehearsal this morning and it took me 30 minutes or more. But since we have only 15 minutes, so I have to rush through all the slides, but I really want to ask for your collaboration by asking you to be very attentive. And I did the copy most of my the details of the content today on the slide, which is not a good design of presentation, but this for today. Okay, and also one more thing, I did skip one part, which is the introduction of my university. So please don't tell my boss that I did this, because I think you, most of you can see from, can look it up from the website about ChiangMai University, or most of the Thai audience already know about Thai, my university. First of all, ChiangMai University was lucky enough to be selected to be one of the first university that doing MOOCs for Thailand, in the Thai MOOC. So this is the first MOOC program for our Thai audience. It consisted of three courses. We call it IT for Specific Purposes program. And it consisted of three courses, which is IT for education, IT for management, and IT for English. And it was launched last August. And most of my team and I have been doing this, working very hard on this, on designing this course for, we spent almost a year just trying to design this in order to make it effective as possible. And today, I'm so glad to share with you some of the impacts and also some of the things that I learned from doing this for a year. Okay, and I shared this with the Thai audience in Mae Fa Luang around I think 2 months ago. This one I would like to share with you, the international speakers and participants for this event too. The three major factors that I found learners from our MOOC kind of felt satisfied with our MOOC because of the three things, which is the content that we deliver, we share, and also the learning activities and the learning media that we design. But let me share with you what I mean by the content first so that you understand better. I'll try to make it quick here. It's okay. Can you switch the... Okay. No? It's okay. You can feel from the audio. You can feel from the audio that it's exciting one. We get back to this during the second round. What I'm sharing this is the video of the course that explain the next slide of mine about the content that learners told us that they would like to learn, and that's why we kind of offer. Oh, okay. You want to watch it? Oh, okay. The list of the next program, next courses on MOOCs, which is more 29 more, supported and funded by Thailand Cyber University after our three courses that I will share the result of the findings. But the video here try to share with you is the result of what I survey, and not I, I mean my team and I did survey with the Northern people on what would be the content that they're interested in learning. So we designed the courses in the next program into three categories. I think I put this on YouTube already, so that's maybe after this Lana cooking course, and I will just skip to my presentation. Back to my presentation. Okay. She's almost 70, but she's kind enough to share with us all. All right. Sorry, but I have to rush through this. You can check it out on our YouTube. Okay. Let's come back to our PowerPoint slide. I'm so excited. It's only 15 minutes, so I don't want to spend other speakers' time. So I have to get through this very quickly. Okay. So the content that we found that we allow the learners, especially in the Northern Thai, we survey and that we designed the next course. We selected the next course. Including cooking class, tennis class, and also the orchid planting. And next will be the one which add value to learners' life, including the you see from the video, the dentist assistant skills, nursing for aging people, learning design for corporate, digital literacy, graphic design, computer network system. And the third type will be essential for learners' life. This one will be the focus of my talk today too. The one integrated with the enrolled class in the regular class, the IT for education, for example, and then real life situations such as psychology for adolescent and contemplative education. These are all the 29 courses more that we are doing in the second phase of our MOOC development. And for the learning activities, this is the data is from the first three courses that we launched. We found that, particularly in the course IT for education, we found that the learners love and enjoy learning through various kind of activities that we provide on MOOC, rather than just watch the video-based materials. Second, we found that right design that matches learner characteristics, which is particularly allow them to create works which allow them to apply for what they have learned, similar to Dr. Pong's show us about the balloon thing. That remind me of the activity that we did similar to our class too, but we share it later. We have them come up with the project of IT for education themselves, so they kind of like the idea of applying it, not just watching the video and then doing the exam or quizzes, something like that. And then adult learner, this is interesting too. Adult learners, because there are various range group in my class, so adult learners told me that they like learning with their video, that display in instructor face, they are acceptable. But for youngster, undergrad, they told me that please skip your face. No, I'm kidding. Don't show your face too much. Try to use the new media with graphic. They don't like to see my face too much, that particular. That's it. Okay. And they satisfy with the discussion activity. And adult learner also like the discussion activities that we design for them. But unlike undergrad, they told me that they don't like to discuss that much. They would like to do like activities like short answer, drag and drop, true, false, rather than open-ended questions. This is for Thai context. And these are also the learning, they told me about the learning activity design that they prefer. These are the percentage of what they like. They like, I already say that 42.9% like the creating works that related to what they have learned, as compared to just only a few percent of self-reflection or write for the group activities. And also they told me that they prefer to receive the feedback from teachers as soon as possible. They can bear at a maximum of 3 days are acceptable, but most of them say that 1 day is enough, or else just come to see us face to face. Okay, and they like me to get back, if I want to get back to them, which is the best way, they say Facebook. They use Facebook to get, connect to them, easiest. And second, part of my of the things that they like is about learning media. They told me that the video has to be compact, bite-sized, easy to understand, and entertaining. most of the learners told me that they like the new media type. I already mentioned about this. And the length of the video that should be appropriate is around five minutes long, surprisingly, and no longer than 10. The content has to be well designed, interesting, and fun. That's what they gave us the feedback. And also, if the instructor appear in their video, in our MOOC, please be friendly, create relaxed alertness, smile a bit. And also, teachers or instructors have to use effective presentation technique to explain content clearly. As well as learning media must be offered to learners in various formats. Some prefer video, some prefer audio, some prefer blah, blah, blah. So we should provide not only video-based materials. And the learners like instructor to offer live session too. And but not too much, because it will be similar to face-to-face, and they have to come to the computer or access the computer at a synchronous time. Forget to tell you one thing. May I borrow the Professor Pong's term of asynchronous flipped MOOC? That's the approach that I use for this course for IT for Education. So we still have face to face, but answering to our Yani's questions, we two-thirds online and one-third face-to-face. And we use asynchronous blended. We came to class and then we review, and we have a special session tutoring on what they have learned by themselves from the MOOC. And during the first 4 weeks, most students stated that they prefer MOOC rather than coming to an early class. This class usually offers at 8 a.m. So they're so happy that they didn't have to come to class. You see the number, 83%. Yeah, however, I didn't tell this to Ajahn Anushai yet. However, at the end of the class, which is 9-week class, the numbers go down to around 65%, say that, okay, I still would like to learn from MOOC. So it a bit drop in terms of satisfaction, not drop out, because they need the grade to be graded from this course. And these are the photos of the learning activities during special tutor session that we did. So they have to, the task here is they have to apply what they learn from the MOOC on learning theories and how they are to apply for their teaching. So they divided into group, and then they have the task. They are assigned the task to present of how they thought about each of the learning theories and how they would apply it to their class. And now they came out to present. Very familiar, right? Okay. And they has had to vote on the best presentation work by using the voter, the app. We use the ping pong one. And then I gave an award to the best presentation group. And we ran to the final part of my presentation now. After learning from MOOC, we asked the student to assess their own learning. This is self-assess. Okay.
So sorry.
We found that the student learning from MOOC thought that they could learn. They have to self-assess their learning from MOOC. And the result came out that they say that they could understand and achieve the learning result for around 7 to 80%. And also, this is that self-assess. Okay, and 12% say that they can learn and mastery more than 12%. And 5% they say that they couldn't really get the concept that much for 5%. But why I'm sharing with you this, Surprisingly, when I graded this class, the score came out very similar to what they assessed. So this is very interesting result that I found from this research too, that they know what they have achieved from their own self-learning. This is quite interesting. We never expect that before. Usually they were all rated their own learning, but this is quite true. And if you can choose, I already share with you this, you wish to come to regular class at in the early morning, or you wish to learn from MOOC, and I maybe I should reconsider my own teaching. Well, and then the reason, and they text me the reason, and in English, learners say that they could review the content as many times as they wish. This is what they love most, because they don't have to, mostly they ride a bike, motorcycle. And came to class early, so they don't need to do that. So they can learn at on weekend, and I answer a lot of questions on weekend. So I remember someone said that it's kind of the during the whole teaching experience. Last year was also one of my toughest teaching time in my life, teaching this course too. This is a bit discouraging, but happily tough, okay, for teaching this. And they told me that their content was practical and they liked that. They could apply what they learned to their future work. And they like the content, the design. If I had time, I can show you. But you can see from the video how much time we spend on effort we spend on doing that design, the video-based design. We spend a lot of months doing that. And also, they like it in the way that, because it helped them understand the content through the media. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Associate Professor Dr. Thanomporn, for such a very, very interesting presentation about how to be not, it seems like, you know, it's not only being a MOOC student is challenging, but being a MOOC teacher is even more challenging. So we will keep some questions to ask her during the discussion session later. So may I now invite the next speaker, Professor Dr. Hae-kyoung Nam. He's professor of architectural engineering and also now he's serving as the director of Hanok Technology and Construction Center at Chonbuk National University, Republic of Korea. So everyone please.
How are you? I'm Professor Hae-kyoung Nam at Chonbuk National University in Korea. I'm happy to represent my KMOOC work to you. Thank you very much. I will introduce my the process of production of my Hanok MOOC. So, the subject of my book is an interesting Hanok story. Hanok is the Korea traditional house like this. It is the artificial building, but however, it is combined with the nature, so it is very beautiful and scientific. KMOOC, as you know, Korea massive open online course. Learning method is the professor with multilateral communication between professor and learner, learner and learner. So, I selected my KMOOC 2015 and I produced 2016 and I will distribute this year. This picture is our team report to the MOOC work to the president. Hanok Education of Chonbuk National University is specialized for My university is located in the southwest part in Korea. So it is in Jeonju. Jeonju is the one of the traditional cities in Korea. It is like Yayukata, like in Taegu. So there is a Hanok village that has the 600 houses that is made of Hanok. So it is the famous tourist place to the world. Last year, 6 million visitors came this year. So we specialize Hanok education in our university. We specialize the Hanok project of Chonbuk National University as specialized education of traditional culture and constructing traditional campus building and specialized educational program of Hanok. Prior to online education, we had offline Hanok education. The program is very various and many programs. So we made a department of Hanok in the graduate school. It is the first in Korea. And the Hanok program for university students, as the cultural studies, we managed the Hanok introduction. And my department of architecture managed Hanok architecture and Hanok design and drafting. And Hanok education for architects and skilled workers and foreigners and middle and high school students, teachers, children, their parents, disadvantaged persons, Hanok lifelong education. So this is the program and its training and period. This scene is the department of Hanok at, this scene is the class of department of Hanok at graduation school. This scene is the class of cultural studies Hanok introduction. This scene is the educational program for architect. They are the professional architect. This is the Hanok program for skilled workers. Many of students are the retiree and who live in the farm and rural countries. This is the Hanok camp for middle and high school students. This is the program for children and disadvantaged persons. This scene is the Hanok camp for teachers. The teacher is the middle and high school teachers. This is the Ondol education. Ondol is the Hanok plot heating system. We have the specialized campus at Gochang. There are many buildings like this, and a lot of equipment. They are the best in Korea. As the result of education, we organize Hanok Technology Research Association and organize University Student Founding Club, make the MOU with the local government and the industry and the company. They will give us the chance to get a job. And we exhibit every year for Hanok exhibition. Last year, World Buddhist Exposition, we exhibited the Hanok works. This year in January, we exhibit in the United States of America. And every year, we exhibit Seoul Hanok work exhibition. And we construct four Hanok traditional pavilions as the practice. This scene is the Hanok exhibition and the content. We construct Korean traditional pavilion every year. In this pavilion is constructed in the our university. And it is constructed in the government formal buildings. This is the result of our practice training. And we recommend to the learners to participate in the volunteer activities. So every summer vacation, we did a volunteer activity to repair old houses for rural old persons who live himself or herself. Volunteer activity to repaint in the Jeonju city. Volunteer activity to repair interior house for the disabled person. Every winter vacation, you go to the abroad, like Laos and Vietnam and Cambodia. So in this scene is the process of construction elementary school in Laos in 2015. So we had the offline Hanok education, but prior to online education, you had the online offline education, but the people who had a existing job and live apart from our campus and the parents want to online programs, education programs. So we proposed the MOOC and we selected the Hanok education as the K-MOOC. The background and purpose is the understanding the Hanok characteristics, excellence, science, aesthetics, culture, and developing a traditional technology. The content of Hanok is introduction of Hanok, characteristic of Hanok, aesthetics of Hanok, structure of Hanok, design and drawing of Hanok, construction technology, appreciation, survey, modernization, industrialization. Especially, design and drawing of Hanok and the construction technology of Hanok is the content of practice. So we will show the process of practice in this MOOC project. The curriculum is made of 13 weeks like this. This is the process of production. He's the resident in Hanok house. He explained the process of his construction, his house, and his village. This is the production. And we applied the MOOC to the college student pre-class preparation and additional learning. Two professors use the content during online course. To the university, provide the learning opportunities for courses that are not yet open to the university. Common learners and workers and company employees and retired lifelong learners to learn a new knowledge and get a job. Our learners of the subject of the project is student in the university and graduate school, lifelong education learners. Retiree, public persons, disadvantaged persons, disabled persons, women who live herself, architects, Hanok skilled workers. Especially retirees, though, in Korea, they retire 60 years old, but they are too young to take a rest in the home. So they want to learn more and they want to get a job. So it is good for them to get a job. Our university organized the support to organize the education center for great persons. There are professors, staffs, facility equipment, and supported fund. And we have the specialized campus at Gochang. It is the specialized Hanok campus. There are professors, staffs, facility, and equipment. But there are some problems. We don't have much enough time to produce content, and we don't have enough manpower. So to solve that problem, we work with the undergraduate students and apply the offline materials, make a plan to produce a revised edition, and modify and supplement, and we'll update continuously. Our future planning for the Hanok is the strategy. Propulsion, direction, the number of developed courses. 2015, 2027, and 2018, 500. So we developed many programs, and we expanded K-MOOC education programs, so built an integrated educational system, both offline and online, developed various educational programs, so vocational program to train, and the engineer and the skilled workers. Educational programs for university students, especially lifelong education, hobby classroom. So education program for children, middle and high school boys, disabled person, and education for cultural heritage, especially education program for foreigners and education program for existing employees who get a new job. So finally, we have a plan to develop an education program. So online education and offline education and online education, we build an integrated education system. So if one who wants to learn more theory, he recommended to enlist online education book. If one who wants to learn more practice, he recommended to enlist offline education at Gochang campus. So we would like to build an integrated system. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Nam, for such a very, very interesting another type of MOOC course and program. We will keep the question for him after this session. So next, may I invite the last but not least speaker for this morning session, Professor Tsuneo Yamada, who is now he's the professor of Center for Open Distance Education, Open University of Japan, and formerly he's serving as the Deputy Secretary General of JMOOC. So everyone, please.
Okay, sawadee krap, and good morning. And so as other three, I mean, thank you very much, a very kind introduction. So Dr. Jintavee Jin. And so other three so presenters so show you a very brilliant, rosy future. So I'd like to share our so monotone, a little bit unhappy status quo. And at the beginning, I also should say, this is only my own personal opinion. This is not official JMOOC opinion, and also not for many other Japanese participants. So our university, my organization is Open University of Japan, and our university is a lifelong learning institution and also a distance university. And maybe so, I believe so, Professor Shirai, he will be the introduction in such kind of our background. So I skip to this slide. And you also recognize, so we have many variety of MOOCs at the moment. So developed countries, typically in United States, so some people say MOOC has been over. But their MOOC is evolved in very different way. But in Asia, Pacific area, as you know, so the hype for the MOOC is still keeping high level, and we have, so very fortunately, we can have this kind MOOC stakeholder summit today. And in the MOOC, so all of you knows massive open online course. So it means so we should provide high quality education, not the content, education itself to so many registrants and in free. So we cannot get money from tuition or something. So, but in our case, so our university is the founder of JMOOC. We also provided one MOOC at the beginning, at the establishment of the JMOOC. At that time, we used $200,000 for one course. But now, so we can only 5,000 just only 5% of the initial course development. So this is our reality. I don't know yours. This is our realities. So we have no sufficient budget, and we have no such sufficient staffs. But we should provide high quality education to mass people. So we need to MOOC. This is the platform story. So MOOC is not only scalable learning management systems. We believe MOOC is a kind of a total solution to realize openness and quality assurance at once in sustainable way using technologies. So we realize scalability, sustainability, and quality of educations, and under the very limited our human and financial resources, so we need some technical innovation. So this is the one of the case. So we expected, this is the one of the innovation expected. So we cannot hire many teaching assistants, and we cannot use many budget for the development of content. So we need some kind of the learning management framework supported by machines. And in change the world, it means to realize personalization and optimization of learning processes. So at the moment, we have material repository and sequential course management, the current learning management LMS, and assessment for teachers and learners. But to realize such kind of the MOOC, at the moment we don't have a semantic content repository, artificial intelligence engines for learners and educators, and the metrics and analytics of machine, both for machine and humans. We recognize in recent, in these months, we recognizing so learning analytics is the missing link to realize this kind of the framework. So we should also mention this kind of movement in the United States. So as you know, so the current architecture of learning management systems is a kind of the development of the 20th centuries. So architecture is a little bit not new. So we keep this architecture for 10 or more years. But you also recognize so learner-centered approach is very effective, and active learning is also we should introduce. But when we using the current LMS, so it's a little bit difficult. We have difficulties to implement such kind of new teaching activities. So many people recognize so we need some kind of next of learning management systems. So Educos, this is a very big non-profit organization of academic CIOs and IT centers people, and they under the collaboration is with IMS Global Learning Consortium, they started this kind of the project, the next generation digital learning environment. So in this framework, they say interoperability and integration, personalization, analytics, advising, learning assessment, it include learning analytics and institutional research, and collaboration, accessibility, and universal designs. So so I cannot have time to explain this framework. But anyway, in your university also, we have many database and educational systems, so learning management systems, and also you have library, digital library systems, and also student information systems, and so on. And each system, so every day, so produce log data, but maybe most of us have not so utilize such kind of variable data. So this new framework, Ungduru. What happened? So need such kind of the federation of database and to use this kind of the data. So so our university also a MOOC platform, OUJ MOOC platform. So this is also a pilot case of such kind of next generation digital learning environment. So we have no money, so we cannot develop so MOOC platform from the scratch. So we use the public so but free service like Facebook Facebook, and we recorded our video materials on YouTube, and also we issued our such achievement record in using Mozilla Open Badge, and also we also run so learning management system Moodle, in our case Moodles, in back end. So we combine, so mash up these kind of the public free services and to realize our OUJ MOOC platform. And also we adopted a standard curriculum. This is European curriculum for the language learning. But anyway, so we need to reuse such kind of materials. So we need such kind of the framework, structure of the curriculums. And maybe so I used most of my time. So in our programs, in our courses, high dropout rate. So only 5 to 20% is can finish. And in our analysis, only strongly motivated and well-prepared student can finish the course. So, but yes, and they show more autonomous, flexible, and independent learners. So only these people can finish our course. But most of the students cannot finish. And we also recognize that learner support study is sufficient. But as I mentioned, so to realize such kind of personalization, we should wait such kind of the progress of the technologies, especially in artificial intelligence and learning analytics. So we are now so study these areas. Fortunately, so in many so global learning, international learning, international standardizing bodies in the world in e-learning field. So, so started that kind of the ecosystem to reuse such kind of content, application tools, and sometimes learning activity record. So we observed this kind of the progress. So one of the examples, this IMS Global Learning Consortium's Caliper Analytics Framework. This is a standard to share such kind of personality, the format and communication rules of personal learning log and so on. And another, so we also feels the necessity such kind of materials repositories. So to realize personalization, so we need many kind of the materials, of course. But as you know, so to develop such kind of the variety of the materials, we need much more so money and stuff. So this is also along with the field to collaborate among MOOC providers. So thank you very much for your attention and patience.
Thank you very much, Professor Yamada, to sharing very good practice about MOOC at the program level with us today. So now we have around 30 minutes for the discussion session. So may I now invite the four speakers to be on the stage again and for the further discussion in the detail about our full presentation.
While setting up the stage, may I make one housekeeping announcement, please? At the moment, we have already updated our website. If you want to visit our website, as on your badge, the bottom part, you can get this book from UNESCO, the orange book, PDF version, and also this book, the pink one from Korea. Orange and pink. Available for you to enjoy right now on the website. We also have photo sharing session. So we keep taking some photos and upload to that website. If you click reload, you may be surprised to find your photos. And as a revenge, you can also add your photos back. This is shareable technology, cloud-based. And when the session finish, once you get out of this room, you will be given this green coupon. This is for your lunch. So don't leave the room without this green coupon. Okay, three colors. Orange book, pink book, and green coupon. Okay, three things. Thank you.
We'll come back again on the stage for the awful speakers. I'm sure that everyone here for the this morning session, we have learned a lot. And not only the best practice, lesson learned, we also learned about to see, you know, the perspectives from the four representative for the four countries. So now, may I ask, I think I try to guess, you know, like what people in this room are going to be interested in, and may I start with, I think the most important one is first, to four of you, may I ask about, as we know that nowadays there are many types of MOOC practice. Some you have used MOOC for purely distant education, and some you have used is in the type of branded classroom. And Professor Pong and Dr. Thanomporn have mentioned about branded free MOOC. So there are now we can see, you know, like different types. So can I could you please define MOOC in your context? And in such context, do you think what would be the distinctive points and also the challenging points as well? Two of us here that we can learn from your best practice. Yeah. So, lady first.
Well, in our case, as I explained, our MOOCs are only online, fully online MOOCs. And we don't have, in our distance education regular courses, we don't have either any, like, these examples with face-to-face with the students. Only some areas in science and engineering have compulsory practice-based learning, but not in the MOOCs. Yeah.
And in terms of the national policy, do you have such,
at a national level, there is not a common policy for MOOCs or anything, so nothing else.
Okay. So if so, do you think what would be the distinctive points and also the challenging one that you have been facing so far?
Okay, well, I highlighted in my presentation that to me the challenge was, and I think also it was in the Korean example, to integrate the other courses we have and the MOOCs in our academic offer. But this is more inside the institution. So we are not thinking in a national or European level thing, maybe farther, but first within the institution, how to integrate the MOOCs there. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Ines. So may I ask Dr. Thanomporn for the same?
Okay. As I mentioned during my presentation, that the MOOC that using in at Upper North and especially in ChiangMai University and maybe similar to other universities in Thailand, based on campus students. I shouldn't say for other universities, sorry, maybe some other university may try with a different audience, sorry, for Upper Northern region. Mostly we will use it integrated with our regular classes in our university, and we would highly recommend that we should use similar to Professor Pong said, and I mentioned it a couple of times because I found that it's very interactive and students appreciated it. According to the research that I found, they found it that it's more interactive between among their peers and also with me and them. And so we believe that with asynchronous and which means on their own time, and also with their flipped learning, which means designing it in a careful and systematic way in order that they can understand the content that we would like to, learning in a way that it was supposed to be. So the designing is the issue, but also this designing is also the challenges that I found. As I already touched on that point, that it require a lot of time and effort. That's why I have to restructure this course, even though I taught this course for more than 10 years. But to make it so interactive and into the update, MOOC course way. So we really need, and I didn't do it by myself. I did with the team, instructional designer, as well as talk to a lot of students. Former one and also the younger, because like we all know that the next generation is very different. We shouldn't think that the way that we do always will be the right way. So require time and effort, but I encourage you all to try, because at the end of the class and research, you will be see all the happy faces from and all the feedback and the positive. And we learned that with good faith and all the effort that we put into it, it works because of the student telling us.
It's the happy effort, right?
Happy ending.
Happy ending. Okay.
I'm not ending yet.
What about in your case, Professor Nam? In your case, like what kind of types, MOOC?
My MOOC is the characteristics of the special region. Our city is one of the traditional city in Korea, so we make an effort to supplement our cities. We specialize our Hanok project in university. So, prior to online education, we had offline education of the Hanok. So we will develop and build an integrated system with the online system and offline system. Yes.
Very interesting model of how, you serve the the government and okay. So what about in your from your perspective, Professor Yamada?
Yes. So JMOOC has four MOOC platforms. So we have no free. We mean our university, Open University Japan, has no do not have any. So flipped classroom experience, but maybe in this afternoon, so the representative from other three platforms will be share the experiences, and in our case, so our university have online courses, so in our case, so the number of the registrants in MOOC is sometimes smaller. Than our those of our regular I mean paid online courses, so this is a very serious issues in our case.
Issues and also challenging, happy challenging too. Like
I'm not sure at the moment.
Okay, sir. We can see like now different kind of MOOCs in terms of the course and program now. Another thing that you know we all now in this room interesting is about the assessment and evaluation. Especially when you're dealing with a large number of students in some cases, it's always been challenging how you evaluate and in order to decrease the dropout rate. So what would be, can you share with us the effective methods to assess and evaluate the learning outcome for the MOOC learners?
Well, I think assessment is one of the key issues in education and also in MOOCs. And I have been very interested in that topic, and I have been participating in some European projects about assessment and how to improve that, and to understand assessment as a part of the learning process, and not as something so separated. And here, I think we have to improve a lot of things also in our regular teaching. In my case, I always mix in my reflections the MOOC and the regular courses we teach, because they are not so different in my case. They are both online. And we use, I use, the Bloom taxonomy. Are you familiar with that, about learning objectives? And the one of the biggest problems is that in the MOOCs or with the assessment methods that we can use with massive number of students or learners, sometimes it only appeals to the more basic levels in the Bloom taxonomy, so lower level skills, like remember or recognize, memorizing, is very related to information transmission and lecturing model, which is quite common in MOOCs as well, lecture and quizzes. And I also use that in my regular courses and in the MOOCs, but with the limitation that teachers have to be aware that they don't reach the higher level skills. And for that, one of the solutions could be to get e-assessment tools that can support automatic assessment of open-ended questions, for instance. I think this is one of the things that will be developed in the next years, maybe with artificial intelligence and semantic analysis. And one of the research groups in my university is working on that, on supporting automatic evaluation of essays. It's in the initial moments, but I think that would be important. So to have some support so teachers don't have to assess individually each of the thousands of assessments. And another big part is to get the support from peers. And peer assessment as first as a learning tool, because learners learn a lot when they have to assess other learners' activities or performances. And I also use that in my regular courses. For instance, in a master course that I teach, students have to evaluate other students' projects, and they learn a lot in that, and it helps me also for the evaluation at the end. And in the MOOCs, I think that's a very important part. And the MOOC platforms have already incorporated this evaluation system, the peer evaluation. I use it in my MOOC. But in the MOOC, not many learners undertake that activity. Most of them only watch the videos, some of them take the quizzes, and only very few of them do the essay or the written assignment and do the peer assessment. But I think that's something that should be promoted, and I strongly believe in the peer work and collaborative work also in MOOCs.
In our context, since this is part of our course, so students and learners are required to do the pre-test. Actually, we design in a way that they have to do the pre-test, and then after learning and completing all the activities, they're supposed to do that, but they can skip anyway. But they have to take the post-test after each, not only each module, but also the each unit that we divided into small pieces. And also we do give this some assignment on, we had one assignment on reflective paper, and that's require a rubric that our team design, and usually we had the keywords and all the aspect that we would like to assess them. Basically post-test and one paper. Okay.
I have a lot of difficulty to assess and evaluate the learners because they are very massive. So, especially my subject is composed of theory and practice. It is very difficult. I don't have any special method of the evaluation and assessment now. But as possible as I gave a chance to learners to make questions and quiz by email. So I answered them. Yes.
Question answer, the traditional one first.
In our case, so we can use only just very simple multiple choice type quiz and the analysis of the discussion or bulletin board or something. But we also try to MOOC platform provider did such kind of peer review systems, but at the moment we cannot touch it. And also we are very interested in such kind of personal achievement record, the combination or integration of such kind of personal achievement record and learning process, so learning activity data. But we just started such kind of the federation or integration of siloed educational systems. So maybe in the near future, we'd like accomplish such kind of thing.
Thank you very much. So seem like that all of the four speakers have used, of course, the compulsory that we must have is the quiz or the exam at the end to measure that students have learned. And also some of you have do the process evaluation, I would say, for example, like Ajahn Thanomporn mentioned about the reflection along with the rubric, right? And Professor Yamada mentioned about the personal learning record. So things like we evaluate the process of learning as well, and not only the outcome. And also Professor Ines and also mentioned something about peer assessment to evaluate during their learning too. So can I have one more last question? Okay. So the answer maybe can be very short one, but I would like to see to ask that what would be the future direction for each of you in terms of the MOOC course and programs. So we can take, please.
So do you mean the in our own institution or the trend in the world or our opinion?
Maybe from your perspective or in your context, like what would be the future direction at your institution?
Okay, well, I think in my institution, or I hope so, this is at least what I tried when I was the head of the MOOC program, is again to integrate more the MOOCs. So we can take advantage of what we already do in my university. So if we have very good programs in a master program or an undergraduate area, then to have MOOCs about that. So to build upon our strengths and professor or research strengths. And to integrate, so to have more modular structure. And I think MOOCs are good for that because MOOCs are usually short and they you can get certificates for each of them. So for the learner's perspective, I think it's helpful to build their, maybe to accumulate different MOOCs that can lead them to a higher or a bigger degree. So we can structure that in that way. So I think that would be a good option, and I think that that was happening in other platforms like Udacity. They are promoted in the micro degrees, or is they have another philosophy. But I think we can try to structure our all the academic offer in a more flexible and modular structure. I think one important thing for the future is to work on the recognition and on partnerships. So that's why I think your initiative here with this memory of understanding between the three Japanese and Korean and Thailand MOOCs is very important, because it helps to build to do all this in coordination for maybe a wider area in the Asia Pacific area. So recognition and integration, well, the key always remains the assessment, as I said, and I think what most of us are in the same point, that we are aware that we need to be stronger on that. And I think also that the learning analytics will be more developed in the future, and the role of artificial intelligence, also the robots in the courses. Maybe I'm not so... I don't know, so sure about the role, because I think they could be very useful for replying to very administrative questions from the learners, but not so much about the content. I think teachers, professors' role is still very relevant in the distance courses, MOOCs or other online courses, but the robots could be helpful for some of the tasks. Yeah.
Thank you. So the speaker, can we have maybe very short brief one, because the time is running out and we're afraid that, you know, when we get to the buffet and everything all gone. So maybe like...
Okay, which is not good. We just for us, we will try to expand the use of the courses that we design to in a nationwide level, maybe with the support of Thailand Cyber University, and maybe with the JMOOC and KMOOC, which is today inauguration. So we might want to try to expand some of the courses that you might look interest in, and then like Lana food, maybe connect with Korean or Japanese food, and then we will do some collaboration and perhaps research collaboration, which is very important.
I think that MOOC will be extended widely, because our program, there are many old people and some foreigners. So the population of the old increases. So they retired at 60 old ages. So they are too young to take a rest in the home. So they want to learn more and get a new job. So it will be widely and. The world will be the one. So to understand and exchange each other culture, to know the another country culture is very important. So the MOOC is will be expanded widely. Yes.
And technically, so massiveness, so scalability issues is not a big difference with between. MOOCs and other open online courses. So we consider so MOOCs platform can be used in the traditional so universities for the educational reform or teaching or learning improvement. So this is just only my idea. So I'm sure, but MOOC can be a kind of the frontier test. Provide a frontier test bed for all levels of education, so we can so stress so such kind of the merit very positively.
Okay. So everyone, please again give a warm, a big applause to our awful, distinguished, awesome speakers, Professor Yamada, Professor Ines, Professor Thanomporn, and Professor Nam. And I will give the floor back to Dr. Warsung.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jintavee and all the guests. Don't know how to thank you enough, but another round of big hand, please. Okay, without further delay, we're gonna have our afternoon session start at 1:30. A lot more prominent speakers from around the world waiting for you in the afternoon, so don't miss it. Come back at 1:30. And when you go out, please don't forget to collect this green ticket. And the food is served on the first floor. Thank you. Enjoy your lunch before the lunch runs out. Thank you.